Hello everyone, today we are going to start with our chapter number 1, formally. So this chapter is named, What is Psychology in Your Textbook? We'll be starting off today with the definition of psychology and we'll also learn some important keywords related to the definition. For this, I would request all of you to open up page number 3, chapter 1. On the left column, you find 6th line from the top. This is the definition of psychology. Here, psychology is defined formally as a science which studies mental processes, experiences, and behavior in different contexts. So let us just break this definition into parts and then try to understand what this discipline of psychology is exactly about. If you break this definition into parts, it is a science which studies mental processes. Now the question is, what are mental processes? Mental processes are all those processes which are going on inside your head when you are interacting with the world around you. For instance, when you are listening to this lecture, you are seeing the visual in front of you and you are listening to the sound which is coming to your ears. Now, this effort on your part to attend to the sound and listen to the sound, what the words mean, this is a mental process. This is something which you call as attention. You are paying attention to the sound which is coming to your ears. When you pay attention to this sound which comes to your ears, you are able to get the meaning of the words. So, this is a mental process. When you attend to something, when you try to solve a mathematical problem, when you try to solve a daily life problem, for example, you have lost the keys and you are not able to open the door of your house. Now, what do you do? Now, when you think about multiple options of going inside your house, how to go inside the house, how should I look for another key, or should I break open the door, or how should I look for a window through which I can just, you know, slip inside the house? These are all mental processes. So mental processes are all those processes which are going on inside your mind. It's very interesting to note that mind and brain are two different things. There is a brain activity which is going on. Suppose you are solving a mathematical problem. There is a brain, there is a neural activity which is going on inside your head. And simultaneously, at the same time, there is a mental activity going inside your head. The neural activity and the mental activity which involves solving that problem. You are thinking about possible solutions to the problem. You are thinking about the steps which you would be taking in order to solve that problem. So all this is the mental process. Brain activity and mental processes are two overlapping processes but different. The neural activity involved in solving a mathematical problem is what the brain does, and the fact that you are solving the problem, you are thinking about it, you're thinking, your focus, the amount of focus that you give, the amount of attention that you give to the problem, the amount of effort you are putting in, how motivated you are to solve the problem, all these are mental processes. Coming to the second part of this definition, which is the experiences. Now, what do we understand by experiences? What is the meaning of experiences? We sometimes talk about, you know, I had a very bad experience that day. I went to the mall and the shop I was looking for, the outlet, the eating outlet that I was looking for was closed. What do we mean? I had a very bad experience. What do we mean by this when we say that, you know, we had a very bad experience? Experience is something which happens to the individual. So there is something which you think about, you feel about, something that happens to you. That is experience. In psychological terms or psychological language, let us again go to page number 3 and look at how the textbook explains experience. Now, textbook talks about the experience in terms of its subjective nature. Now, what is subjective? Experiences are subjective. They say experiences are subjective. What is subjective in experiences? To understand subjective, let us first understand what is objective. Something which is objective is out there in front of us. It can be seen. For instance, you right now in front of you, you must be having a screen. So there is, this is something objective about it. You have something written in front of you. You have something which is coming to your ears, you know. So this is objective. Something which can be seen, which is there, out there, which can be seen, observed, measured, that is objective. Subjective, on the other hand, is the opposite of objective. Something which cannot be seen, something which is difficult to measure, something which is difficult to observe also. So experiences are subjective means experiences are often individual nature. So one who experiences has a subjective awareness of that experience. So if I say that I had a bad experience, only I know that what it meant on that day to have that experience. It is my subjective consciousness. Okay, it cannot be observed from outside. It can be known to others if I choose to tell about it, or if only if I can reflect and, you know, use words or pictures or other medium to express what I went through. So this is something which is inside me, which is in my subjective awareness, in my conscious awareness, which cannot be seen from outside, which is inside, which is hidden, and which can only be known if there is an effort on the part of the person to tell about it. Using any medium, using language, using poetry, using paintings, using music. So experiences are subjective in nature. Experiences are unique to, they belong to the person to whom they happen. Others may not have any idea of it because they are subjective, they are not objective. Let us now go to behaviors. What do we mean by behaviors? Behaviors, on the same page number 3, you can read it. Behaviors are responses or reactions we make or activities that we engage in. If you go back at the back of the book to the glossary section, it defines behavior as any covert or overt action or reaction a person or animal does that can be observed in some way. So what we understand from this definition, behaviors are reactions or actions on the part of the organism, be it any organism, and they can be observed. So they are actions and reactions of the individual or the organism, and they can be observed from outside. And the other part is that behaviors can be covert or overt. Now, what do we mean by overt and covert? Overt behaviors are behaviors which can be observed from outside. Okay, so right now when you are looking at the screen, one can see that you are looking at the screen. One can see that you are writing something. One can see that you are sitting. So all these behaviors which can be observed from outside are overt behaviors. Behaviors, what are covert behaviors? Covert behaviors are behaviors which cannot be seen from outside. They can only be inferred. Now, what do we mean by it? All the mental processes which we learned a little while ago about, such as sensation, attention and perception, learning, memory, thinking, motivation, emotion, all these are covert behaviors. These are covert behaviors because these cannot be seen. If you are listening to my lecture and if I ask you a question and you give me a response to that question which is correct, from this I can infer that you were attending to the lecture. So your attention cannot be seen. I cannot see you attending. I can only see you sitting and looking at me or looking at the screen. That is overt behavior. Okay, so what is covert is something which is going inside your mind. The fact that you are paying attention, the fact that you are giving focus to what you are listening to, the fact that you are trying to gather meaning out of what you are listening to, these are called covert behaviors. These cannot be seen. These can only be inferred. On the other hand, overt behaviors can be seen. A person is running, it can be seen. But what the person is thinking while the person is running cannot be seen. So thinking is a covert behavior, running is an overt behavior. A student is sitting in the class. Overt behavior is this child is sitting. The child can be observed to be sitting in the class. But whether the child is paying attention or not, whether the child is trying to gather meaning or not, whether the child is learning anything or not, that cannot be observed. That can only be inferred from the results that you bring after the exams. So, overt behaviors are behaviors which can be observed from the outside. Covert behaviors are behaviors which cannot be observed from outside, which happen within the mind of the individual. So, if we put together all these three elements and again go back to the definition, psychology is the science which studies mental processes, experiences and behaviors in different contexts. Now, what are different contexts? Different contexts refers to different situations. For example, if you are sitting in the classroom, your classroom is your situation. That is a context. When you are sitting at home and listening to this lecture, it is a different context than a classroom. So context is a situation. For example, people, when they go to their workplaces, how they behave, how they think, you know, what are their mental processes, what are their behaviors, and what do they experience as individuals is different than what they experience, behave, and mentally process when they are at home. So home is a context, family is a context or a situation. Office is another context or situation. When you go to your friend's place for a party, that situation is altogether another context. This will be clearer if you read this two paragraphs which are given here on page number 5. They are telling you about two stories of two children, Ranjita and Shabnam. And if you read the stories of these two children, you will get more clarity in terms of what it means when we say social context. What exactly is social context? Okay, so social context in a nutshell refers to all the conditions or factors or variables which differentiate one individual from the other individual. So psychology is the study of mental processes, experiences and behaviors in different social contexts. So in this lecture, we have understood the definition of psychology, the meaning of different keywords such as mental processes, experiences and behaviors. We have also understood what it means to study these mental processes, experiences and behaviors in different contexts. So that's all for today's lesson. Happy learning. Thank you.